Attorney Shell, based on what we saw on the footage available online and on media reports coming in from the province, it was a clear violation of arrest procedures. Why do you think it's taking time for authorities to actually hold these policemen into account?
I think it has a lot to do with the situation that's happening there on the ground. And what really worries me is the fact that when you expand the power to make warrantless arrests, especially when you claim that it's one of hot pursuit, obviously in this case, there was no hot pursuit. In fact, by the own account of the law enforcers here, they had met with Jade and the others and had invited them to the precinct way before they were even arrested. So I don't see how that could be considered a case of hot pursuit. Now, of course, we can expect, and in my experience, it does happen that the law enforcers dig down and say and insist that what they did was legal and say, just tell us, leave it to the courts to decide. Well, that's where we are right now. Now we are seeking remedies from the courts for their release and for the dismissal of the case.
What kind of message does this actually send to Filipinos in far-flung barangays wherein the police seem to enjoy more of their powers compared to here in Metro Manila, where they are placed under usual and consistent scrutiny by the media and other sectors?
Well, that's the thing. I think the case of Jade shows us that this kind of incident can happen to anyone. We can all be victims of this kind of abuse. And we have to be vigilant, and we have to use as well the power of social media. So even if you're in a far-flung area, I think you will still have access to social media, and we'll be able to get what happened across to the public that way.
It's another example of speaking truth to power, of holding power into account, but that message doesn't actually really reverberate in far-flung areas, in far-flung barangays, wherein citizens are not as empowered as they are compared to the capital region. How do you actually remedy that situation on the ground, wherein people somehow still feel powerless against authorities that are supposed to serve them in the first place?
Well, I think that we all have a voice. It's just a question of finding it. And we must make sure that our people know that their power, the power of government, comes from all of us. That's very clear in our Constitution. Now, I think that the problem that we've experienced is that our democracy has been under attack. Our freedom to express ourselves has been stifled in many ways because of what has happened in the last 6 or 7 years, where even ordinary netizens were harassed, some were even arrested simply for expressing themselves. But one lesson I believe we have learned from our history and even from recent incidents is that we cannot just sit down and keep quiet, because that is really surrendering our democratic space. If we are victims of abuse, I believe the best remedy we have is to let it be known to the public and to fight for justice. Justice in our country is so elusive, but it's so ironic that it seems that for ordinary people, they have really little confidence, when what we need is a justice system that works for everyone.
Mm-hmm. And is the case of Jade Castro, just to wrap up our discussion, among the things that would actually convince you to finally file a certificate of candidacy come October?
Well, you know, Jade Castro's case is just one of several that I'm involved in now. But it's funny in the sense that all of the cases I'm handling now involve our liberties. And that is something that really concerns me, that there continue to be violations of our basic rights, and we have to keep fighting so that we can remove impunity from our country.
All right, and with that, we will have to wait and see on whether or not you will actually turn that statement into a campaign message with the help of your award-winning director's son come October. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, human rights lawyer Shell Jongno. Yeah.